one who made heaven and earth, you're mighty. You're stronger than any other. One thing that I desire of you, and I may dwell here with you forever. I'm chasing no other. When I come to the end of myself, Father,
morning, everyone. Morning. I'd like to go to our opening hymn, which is My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
best. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand. All over ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath is come.
Thank you for today. We thank you, Father, for the bright sunlight, oh Father God, and the wonderful weather that we're having. Father, we thank you that we are able to celebrate the life of our dear sister today, oh Father God, who we know is around the throne today with you, oh Father God, absent from the body but present with you. So, Father, we give you thanks as we have this celebration of her life, a celebration of her strength in you, a celebration of her commitment to you, O Father God, a celebration of her service to you, O Father God, and a celebration of the legacy that she has left behind. Father, as we are gathered here today, help us to celebrate her life, all that she has accomplished, all that she was, and all that she was in you, O Father God. So, Father, bless us this day. Bless us as we have this celebration, and help us to have a wonderful celebration, oh Father God, because we know that she is in your bosom right now. Father, bless today's proceeding, and may it be flow in a manner, oh Father God, that will not be delayed or any problems, oh Father God, but everything will go according to you and to your desire. Father, we give you thanks. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Today, as we are gathered here to celebrate the life of Sister Mcnaught, Sister Victoria Mcnaught, Sister Mcnaught, I see many familiar faces and some new faces, but we're all here to celebrate the life of Sister Mcnaught. And one thing we know, and we know well, I am hoping that today, Pastor, and those who come here often know that when Sister Mcnaught comes to speak, Brother Mike, and when Brother Mike used to lead, he would have to hide the microphone from her or hold on to it, because if she hold on to it, it's a problem to get it from her. Amen? So we are hoping that we won't have to come and take the mic from anybody this morning. Bless God. Amen? Amen. So at this time, we're going to go into our first lesson, and then we have after that our musical selection, and then another selection. I am going to invite Michaela Mcnaught, who is a granddaughter, to be coming with our first lesson, but I'm also going to ask Anthony Mcnaught, Chelsea Shepherd, who is a granddaughter, Anthony's son, and Chantel Mcnaught to all be standing by. I will not be at the podium until Chantel is completed. So you can go ahead, Michaela.
Our first reading is a portion from St. John 11, verses 11 to 27. After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Then Thomas said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us go now, that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied. "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." Here ends the reading of a portion of God's holy word.
One day, Lord, you took her with me. no warning in advance. And I'm begging now, please give me one last opportunity. If there's a phone in heaven, let my mama talk to me.
Church. The second scripture reading will be taken from Psalm 91, NIV version. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely He will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night, nor the arrow that flies by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness, nor the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. You will obey, observe with your eyes, and see the punishment of the wicked. If you say, the Lord is my refuge, and you will make the Most High your dwelling, no harm will overtake you. No disaster will come near your tent, for he will command his angels concerning you to guard you in all your ways. They will lift you up in their hands so that you will not strike your foot against a stone. You will tread on the lion and the cobra. You will trample the great lion and the serpent. Because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call on me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Here ends the Bible reading.
us your way. You always walk a step behind. So I was the one with all the glory, while you were the one with all the strength.
This time we'll be going into a time of tributes, and we'll be inviting Sister Carmen Bull, Pastor Damien Black, and Mr. Vincent Fife in that order.
Good morning, church. Good morning, Mcnaught family. It is a sad day, I know, but I do have the distinct honor of presenting a tribute in honor of the life of our dear Sister Victoria Mcnaught. I first became acquainted with Sister Mac at Hopefield Church, where we first worshiped, 18 Hopefield Avenue, and my husband was pastor there. It is a hard day, as I said, and to the grieving family, the Hopefield flock, the Kencot flock, has lost a gem, a woman of power and great faith. My sincere condolences to you all. Now, church, I'm not here to speak about a flawless woman, because God's word is the only thing I know that's flawless. I'm not here to speak about a woman who's perfect, because God's word is, or he himself is, the epitome of perfection. But I can tell you, I'm here to tell you about the unwavering faith in God that Sister Mcnaught lived out. In my reflection of her, the Lord led me to the story Jesus himself had experienced with a Canaanite woman. She came to him and asked him to heal her daughter. They had a wonderful conversation back and forth. And in that end of that conversation, Jesus said to her, "You are a woman of great faith. Now that's our Sister Mac." I know, and many of you know, she had many conversations with her Jesus. Many of those conversations, she came away saying, "Yes, he heard and he answered." Sister Mac never lost an opportunity to give a testimony of God's goodness. That's how we remember her, one of the ways we remember her at Kencot. Even my daughter Brianna, when I told her she had passed, she says, "Wow, I do remember her coming forward, Mommy, many times giving a testimony of God's goodness. She had a word of encouragement for someone." Brianna also described her as the matriarch of our church and the matriarch of the Mcnaught family. She went on to say Sister Mcnaught was present and up front and center, and that she was. She admired her regal deportment, and she said she was always well-dressed and fashionable. She remembered those wonderful hats she would wear. Brittany remembers her spirit of gratitude. Brad remembers her specifically because they shared the same birth month. And I remember Sister Mac saying to me, as November drew near, she said, "Sister, bold, the time is coming. The time is coming." And going, and you know, that right hand was in the air. She looked forward to the celebration of her birthday when she, Bradford, and our dear brother Baker would be standing here. And she always had a poem to share with us in gratitude for God's goodness. I remember how excited she was about her birthdays. Sister Mcnaught, I knew her as a kind lady. I experienced her kindness in many ways, in her words and so on. And can I pause here to say, in speaking about Sister Mac, it's going to be very difficult to be brief. So our elder will probably have to come and try to take the mic from me, like we used to have to do with Sister Mac. She was kind. And I remember those potato puddings she would bake for Pastor and our family. You know, the kind that you would describe as hill atop, hill bottom, and hallelujah in the middle? That was Sister Mac. Her pudding was sumptuous and delicious, and we thoroughly enjoyed and missed them when the family decided, and we did too, "Sister Mac, it's too much for you. You're not young. You're getting older. So you can't be before the fireplace doing this." But we appreciated her kindness to us. Pastor speaks so admirably of her. One incident he cited was at Kencot here, we had an annual prayer vigil, all night of prayer. And Sister Mac, in her old age, would sit through it all not just sit, but you know her posture, arms folded. She never winked, she never blinked. She stayed awake and prayed and joined all the groups. That was something Pastor remembered of her. I remember her distinguished gait. You know, she had a little forward pitch like this. And she entered the sanctuary with such poise and grace. Always impeccably dressed. If it's a casual event, she's going to be impeccable. But on Sunday mornings, she was well put together. One member reminded me that, you know, she had her own sense of style, and it was really admirable. As our Victoria made her way to her seat, she found the time to bless someone, to touch someone, and to give a word of encouragement. She acknowledged everyone who was in her path. But you and I know, Kencot folks, Sister Mac never minced words. She was honest, and sometimes, to those who didn't understand her depth of love for them, it seemed like she was brutally honest, but she's going to say it. I experienced that in the sense that she said, Sister Bolt, you know you're the pastor's wife, and that I did. She said, you can't wear those sleeveless clothes like some of these people are wearing. You have to stand out as being different. And I received it with grace. One member said to me, as she knew I had to do this tribute, she said, I remember Sister Mac. She took communion preparation so seriously. That was her act of service, one of the many acts of service. She was sincere about it. And this member said, Sister Isis, she taught me, let's pray before we handle these emblems. Let us give God thanks and wash our hands before we attempt to prepare these special emblems for the memorial of our Lord. I believe that Mommy Mac, as I like to call her, was our own Titus II woman. She encouraged the older woman, she encouraged the young woman and the children. She encouraged our women to love your husbands, to be chaste, to be pure. Don't bother in.